Hello, and welcome back to Sam's Disney Diary. Happily Ever After has returned to Walt Disney World's Magic Kingdom. The fireworks extravaganza features lights, lasers, and special effects, including a few new enhancements for its return. Take to bring back an iconic show and add a few new twists. Disney Live Entertainment show producer James Silson provided some insight into creating, bringing back, and adding magic to Happily Ever After. This is the full conversation that took place on the Tomorrowland Terrace with Cinderella Castle in the background getting ready to perform the return of Happily Ever After. Hit that subscribe button for more. Take it away,
James. Yeah, I'm James Hilton. I'm the show director of Happily Ever After. I work Disney Live Entertainment. We're super excited to be bringing this show back. I think a lot of people are. Yes?
Yeah.
Opened the original show. So I was the original show director for Happily Ever After back when we debuted it in 2007. And I thought I'd start by just telling you a little bit about the show itself and just kind of regrounding us on the storytelling of that. And then we'll talk about the new stuff that we're adding. So Happily Ever After, you know, really ultimately the story is a hero's journey. It really is about following our scenes through the lens of our characters, a journey that it takes to start from one place and arrive at the Happily Ever After. Basically the mentality being that, you know, we can have all the dreams in the world, but if we're not bold enough to pursue those dreams and reach out and grab our dreams, they'll never come true, right? So we want to make sure that we're empowering ourselves to take that step forward and achieve our dreams. So that was the mentality behind the storytelling of the show. And through that, we kind of looked through that lens and said, you know, interesting enough, all of our stories, pretty much across the board for all the films, seem to follow that same trajectory. You know, you always have that one character or two characters that have a certain dream that's pulling to them, a voice that's calling to them, something that they desire to do, and then they set off on a journey to find that. And along the way, they meet people, they find love, they have all these experiences, they face adversity, challenges, they overcome these hurdles. And then eventually, because of their perseverance, because of their desire to achieve their dream, they end up seizing their dream, right, and realizing it. And in essence, finding their Happily Ever After. And so those became the beats of our story, right? We start off with a beautiful song that kind of welcomes you into the storytelling, that hero's journey statement. And then we, in essence, each segment kind of is a playbook for how you get there. So it starts with the dream, of course, Tiana kicks us off into that, looking at the wishing star, and then it takes us into the journey segment, which, you know, that kicks off with, you know, a little bit of Cars action into Moana, and then we go into friendship, the idea that you find friends along the way to help you out, then eventually you find love and you discover that, and that makes your takes your dream to another level, right? It takes what you already were trying to pursue, but it's so much sweeter when you have someone next to you pursuing it with. And then that takes us to adversity, of course, which is that showdown against the villains. In our mind, the villains are that adversity, but really that can be any hurdle in our lives, right? We all have villains, they don't have to be actual characters that we're trying to achieve and push past, right? And then eventually, because we overcame that, you know, we may be broken, we may be battered, but we still have that dream, that spark inside of us that really wants to be ignited, right? And through that igniting, that's the idea of the Emperor's Mufasa statement that takes us into the triumph moment, right? Where we get to see all of our heroes together in one beautiful tableau of accomplishment, right? The end of their journey. But what was beautiful about this show specifically was that, you know, we could have told a story just like that and ended it, you know? But that doesn't leave our guests much. It's entertaining, for sure. And of course, all of our guests love to see the characters, love to see the projections on the castle, the beautiful castle statements, the pyro, the lighting, all these beautiful things that we do. But, you know, we have a great opportunity with a nighttime spectacular. You know, so one time when we have the entire, almost all the guests that day, kind of coming together for that one nice statement of us watching the castle and having that one kiss goodnight, it's a great opportunity to leave a message with them they can take on with them. And for us, for this show, it's about empowerment. It's about the idea of saying, you know, sure, these stories have come to an end, but yours continues, right? And as long as you believe in yourself, you believe in your dreams, and you're bold enough to go out and pursue them, if you realize that you yourself have the magic inside of you to achieve your dreams, to achieve your Happily Ever After, you can get it, right? And then everybody leaves with that empowerment. which for me was a really important thing, for sure, when we were designing the show. We had a wonderful team when we first started this process so many years ago now. And the one thing that remained consistent through all of our creative disciplines, pyro designers, our artists, our projection, you know, masters, you know, across the board, our creative director, Michael Young, who I'm sure you've seen interviews with on this. The one thing that remained constant throughout was that we all believed fully in this idea of we have the power to achieve our dreams, and we want to be able to share that with our audience. And what greater platform than a nighttime spectacular at Walt Disney World, right? So that's Happily Ever After. Has everybody seen Happily Ever After?
Yeah, probably.
Yeah, great. It's one of my favorite shows. I don't know why. I'm not biased or anything. So, you know, now we're bringing it back, which of course is fantastic. We're super excited. We know the guests and the mini Disney fans are really excited too. And we just have been so, you know, really touched by the amount of love and warmth and embracing of this this wonderful, wonderful show. You know, sometimes, you know, magic's in a bottle sometimes, you know? And as, you know, I've been working for this company for a very long time. I've been directing shows for this company for a very long time. And, you know, this particular show, we went off on this journey and directed this particular piece. You know, it's just one of those shows that for whatever reason, we all just kind of synergized so comfortably around. And the team all felt really united across the board. There was no separation of disciplines. Like, everyone had ideas that came to the table with it. It was an extremely open collaboration. And truly magic in the bottle. It's one of those shows where at the end, we don't even know how we got there, but we did it, you know? And we could applaud ourselves, say, yeah, all right. You know, now let's try to duplicate that. No pressure. So that's kind of that mentality of creating Happily Ever After. So that's that piece of it. So now let me talk about where we are now. So we're bringing this show back, which of course we're really excited about. Prior to this show, of course, Enchantment came during the 50th. And with that came the Main Street Projections, which was a new thing for us here at Magic Kingdom. We had been doing it in Disneyland for a period of time and I think some of the other parks around the world, but not here at Walt Disney World. And so, you know, we didn't have this when we created Happily Ever After initially. We didn't have the opportunity to immerse our audience into the worlds that we were creating for the castle. And so Enchantment really was a gift for us and brought that to us. And so now, having the opportunity to revisit the show and reopen it for our guests, it was an opportunity to kind of take a look at our Main Street specifically and see how we could tell that story on Main Street as well. And a big part of that was about just recognizing that there's a sheer beauty to the castle and to the decor and to the environments that we're creating. And how do we extend that down Main Street so that our guests are really immersed and almost standing within the castle? And that was the mindset behind how we could extend this show down Main Street. So that's the big new thing when it comes to Happily Ever After. The rest of the show, we've really kind of left the way we wanted it to be. I think it was always effective. It always felt, you know, really poignant with every guest that saw it. And so, you know, it's not about reinventing the wheel or trying to recreate the magic. The magic's there, you know. The real mission on this particular project was, how can we extend that magic to the audience that is further away from the storytelling of the castle and more firmly immerse them in that storytelling. So we're really excited about that. The projections came out really well. I think everyone's going to be really happy with that. We're very excited. And yeah, I can't wait to open it tonight. I'm ecstatic because I love this show.
So are we.
And you never know with these shows. You don't know what's going to happen. And so you create these shows and it's like a baby, you know. You raise it, you send it off to college, and you just don't know what's going to happen after that, you know. And so it's great that, you know, this particular child's coming back home, which is wonderful. You know, when you're creating a spectacular, or any show really, you know, you make certain decisions along the way, and one of them is, you know, who's the storyteller of your show, and what should be the focal point of that, right? And in Happily Ever After, we endowed the castle as the storyteller, truly. The idea being that, you know, all the magic started with the castle transforms first, and everything else kind of manifests from that. So though we're following the character journey, the castle's going on the same journey as our characters, which is why we made choices like the friendship section when the caster suddenly starts singing to us, you know, which is really fun, and somehow feels right for the scene, is because from the beginning we endowed the castle as going on this journey. And likewise, when it came to the great destruction of the castle, right? And, you know, how amazing is it to stand in the hub and watch the castle and see it burn down and become a shell of what it once was, and then you feel this emotional connection to the castle, really. That's what you're feeling. You're going, oh no, I can't believe the castle's been destroyed, this poor thing. Suddenly it has a personality, it has substance to you, it's a character in the play. And how amazing is that? And so then to watch it be reborn, right, the birth of the phoenix mentality, you see it rise up from its ashes and it become greater than it ever was, this golden shining, you know, statement of triumph. You're cheering it on, you're excited, your emotions are high because you watch this happen, and you, in a way, you start identifying with the castle as someone that you can connect with, you know? How interesting is that? And so likewise, with the projection of Main Street, it was really important that we didn't lose that storytelling. You know, we still need our audience to, standing on Main Street, to be able to watch the castle, watch the kind of the show manifest, and feel intrinsically, fully connected and intimately connected to the story that's playing on the castle. And so the show on Main Street is an additive to that, meaning that it basically takes what's happening there and allows it to happen past you as well. So if anything, you're invited to be further in to the picture of the castle and further into the story of the castle, as opposed to finding yourself constantly distracted by things around you that are pulling you out of the story. And so there was a lot of discussion around that, but ultimately that was the choice we made. So the question was, the music of the show is really stellar, and, you know, as a director, does the soundtrack of that kind of live in my head, and how do we get that out onto the castle and beyond? So the honestly, it's a wonderful collaboration with a music team. We have an incredible music department here with wonderful music producers. The music producer for this show was Roger Buttley, who works with us, of course, he's one of our guys. And he works with our composer, our arranger, our songwriters, and me, to and Michael Young, our creative director, and others who come to the table. It's like a table like this of everyone kind of gathering around, throwing ideas in. But part of that, those initial brainstorms, is taking our catalog of songs and saying, here are the beats of the show that we're trying to create, and here are the emotions we're trying to convey. Now, which songs kind of fit that, and how now, if we love these songs, how do we hear them in our heads? And it's really a collaboration. It's not me sitting down, you know, deciding what it is. It's really all of us coming together and going, you know, this song speaks to me for this reason. I love this lyric. I love this feel. You know, this song is great, but can we do it a different way? Because I love this particular piece, but emotionally it needs to say this. These are the kinds of conversations we have with each other to create a score like that. And then it goes beyond that. You know, obviously we have our arranger, we have orchestrators, and we, you know, the score for Happily Ever After was recorded at Air Studios in London, and of course we have people there, we have the giant orchestra. You know, you really don't know what you have until you're standing in a recording studio with a giant orchestra and hearing it for the first time and going, oh, that's what we did, you know? And it's super exciting. We do know that from the feedback from our guests, when we launched the original show, and then the response from the announcer bringing it back, that there's just a love for this particular show, that, you know, we took this opportunity, we knew our fans would love to see it come back. So I think, I'm sure that was part of that decision making, was just knowing that, you know, think about it, we opened the show, it ran for a few years, the great, you know, black hole in our lives happened, and then we came back, and, you know, a show like this, I think, you know, really wanted more time in the sun. And this is an opportunity to have that time. Sure, yeah, the question was, how does it feel to have such a wonderful outpour of love for the show and the feedback and comments and whatnot on social media and beyond? Sorry, I'm paraphrasing your question, but I think that's what it was. You know, honestly, it's really moving. You know, it's really touching. There's, you know, it's again, it's one of those things that, you know, you love something so much, and when you, and I think anyone who creates a show like this, the entire team, really, you know, falls in love with the work they're doing, and you just hope that at the end of it, you think you know, right? But you just hope at the end of it that it's going to be received by your audience the same way with the same love that you've poured into it. And I think, you know, with this particular show, it's really an incredible experience, an incredible feeling to know that that is the case with this one. That we love it, and honestly, yeah, sometimes I wonder if the fans love it even more. but I think there's no ego attached to this kind of work. You know, it's really, you know, especially this particular team that put the show together. You know, we're all like embracing each other and hugging each other, and we're sad to see it go. And you know, we all shed tears over that, and as many others did. And now to bring it back, I think it's just, you know, it's a dream come true kind of moment, right? If I want to get dizzy with it, but nothing to get dizzy with it. Which is good. But yeah, that's how it feels. I think we're all very moved and touched by the outpour of love for it.
Thanks for watching. Hit that subscribe button for more, and make sure you check out the once-in-a-lifetime opportunity to watch Happily Ever After with the 50th anniversary logo on the castle, which only happened one time. Thanks for watching. Call and go, Legion.